Thanks so much. Thanks, Mac. Thank you all first, you know, for this great opportunity for us, this group of artists, coming here to join you in viewing the some of our work, artworks. Tonight, I'm going to present this talk to you. It's about relating to this exhibition, okay? And the first of all is the you know, I want to share this experience about the background of these artists, okay? And so, but I myself is not an art historian, so when I but this is this talk is really about the history of background of these artists, okay? Particularly about the China's art school in its own course of modernization, okay? History evolves, leaving us with consequence. And no matter we hate, we love it, okay? And when we look at that, we may have totally different opinions. And I'm coming here now trying to convince you about my standpoint. Rather, I'm here presenting this talk and showing you some information and to share this, to do this quick review to see how China's modern art school evolves through the history of, really following the development of China's modernization, okay? There's my talk here. And images exceeds 1,000 words, okay? And so I have lots of pictures here. I'm just going to flip through. And here and there, I will give you some of my information, some of the information that I studied, when I prepared this lecture. And actually, it was a very fascinating experience for me, and so many things I didn't pay attention to before, and totally new to me. So here, we're gonna start. Okay, this is a satellite picture of, I need to adjust my adjust my screen, I guess. Okay, it's a satellite picture of Asia, okay. China is located in this, this curve, close to the lower right corner here. And if you look at that land, that green land there, one side is ocean, and the other three sides are very rough terrains, or to some areas, and the temperature is not tolerant for the agriculture development. China has a history of the written history of 5,000 years. But about 2,000 years ago, after quite a long period of warring state years, and China finally settled as a unified country. This is also is a good indicator is about this culture evolves on its own pace, from the very beginning to a mature state. But also it indicates a problem that maybe this, something happening in this land here. And people think the way of thinking start become a pattern, become a custom, people get used to it. So, the call for change is not that kind of urgent. If you look at this land here, living at this side of this, the green land here, you look at the surrounding space. In the ancient time, it's very difficult for people, conquered the ocean to the other land, the other side, any other places. And also at the at this land, at the left side, you see the high terrain, and also north side is the desert, okay? So the natural conditions there is kind of very challenging. So the people inside this land here is pretty much become very mature culture. They stay there. They form a very unique, distinguished culture. Throughout history, for Chinese people, they're not aggressive. It's trying to conquer the world, go outside. So it has a name. It's called Zhongguo, and also Zhongguo means central kingdom. So they consider themselves here in the center of the universe. Okay, But throughout the 2,000 years histories, and China was constantly invaded by the minority groups or the other countries surrounding this land. And twice, China was ruled by the another group of people. For example, the Mongolian came to China, controlled the country. And in the most recent, the last dynasty was Qing Dynasty. It's not the Han Chinese people, it's the majority of Chinese. It's the minority, it's coming from northeast, take over the country, okay. And if we from that, we look at this map here, you see the China, it's the China, it's the map of today, we see it, okay. Chinese art is following this long history evolves, and with its very unique artistic characteristics. This is at an early age when we look at their work, it's really, we don't have the artists with particular names, and all the artisans working together and contribute to this, to the development of the culture. And here we see, you know, a fresco painting. It's in this dimension, and it's a very exquisite, you know, portray of the figure images and the technical controls of the media. It's really reaching a very high mature state. And gradually, Chinese literati paintings appeared. And, you know, there we start to see individuals. And when these artists come in with their intelligence, with their understanding of the space and time, and they start to also use the rice and the ink, rice paper and the ink, you know, develop very unique style. And here is a painting by Shen Zhou. It's very typical, and you see how the ink applied on the paper and in the very particular oriental way of dealing with perspective. It's really, and also it's, this one is by an artist. His name is Wen Zhengming. But from this work, we see is the artist here is really much more concerned about this very harmonic relationship between man and nature. This reflected in Chinese painting, you know, throughout, you know, these 4,000 years of history. In Chinese painting, and we, you know, we more often see this kind of using nature as a metaphor to express the feeling, or to you know, to indicate the artist's their imagination, but the Chinese art education is really has also its own traditional ways, and it's more about copying masters and learn the techniques from the previous generation and that pass through the generations. So this is one of the type of the book. Developed in late Qing Dynasty. But what we see is all artists get a book in hand, they learn the techniques, how to draw the architecture, how to draw the human form, or the nature, or still life. But there was, this is also, you can see, you know, the some of the, you know, the techniques that they are in dealing with the, you know, the birds. And this side is how to teach the young students how to use the brush to portray the, you know, texture of the mountain. But these things soon quickly changed. So in later period of Ming Dynasty, European missionaries came to China, and they come to the, you know, it's really is about after the Renaissance. And this person, his name is Matteo Ricci. He has his name is called Li Ma Dou in Chinese. And he came to China and brought a lot, very interest, lots of scientific knowledge and to Chinese. And also the first time is really for the Chinese court, the emperor, you know, or the Chinese literatis and, you know, these people, the first time to have the encounter, you know, encounter the foreign cultures outside of this boundary of the China. And Matteo Ricci, and he brought the first map of the world to the Chinese people. They, before that, they had no clue about what the outside of China looks, and what about the what about the whole world? And also Li Madou, this missionary made the friends with the Chinese intellectuals and had a good good relationship with the court. And at the same time, he was trying to, you know, convey the Chinese people, you know, to the Christianity. After that, there was another painter. His name is Giuseppe Castiglioni. And he came, he has a Chinese name called Lang Xining, and he came to China in 1715 and also entered into the royal court as a court painter. And this is one of the paintings that he painted during those years. And from this painting, suddenly, you know, he bought, and also beginning from the from Ricci, they both brought very interesting view of the Western painting. And to Chinese, the chiaroscuro, and the sense of realism is really totally the first time for them to see. And here are some of the paintings. Like this is a horse, but the artist here is, you know, using this very, you know, he combined with the Chinese techniques, but also use the the treatment of the Western of using light and shade in depicting the imagery. Okay. And we can see some of the paintings. It's all give this kind of dimensionality. It's about this scientific, in a way, about the anatomies of the animal, and also the space evolved through from the edges to the opposite edges when you see the you know, the treatment of the space. This is also one of the etching that the Royal Court committed, and it's about one of the Qing Dynasty, you know, the army conquered a very remote area in the northwest area to settle the, you know, the to settle a rebellion there against, you know, the central China. And this is only, it's also a very interesting, it's the first picture and also the only picture during that time used the nude figures. As the some of the you know, the enemies try to run to escape from the tent. This is you know, come with the missionary, and you also see the, you know, Christian church built in China. This is one of the quite well known church in Beijing. You know, come with this this kind of architecture, and also there's the imagery of painted form. Also coming with, and also with the sculptures. And that was the church in Wangfujing in Beijing in late Qing Dynasty. This is a scene of today. The church is still there. And also start, you know, at that, from after that, after Lang Xining, we start to see the Western influence, you know, start to start to give an influence to the Chinese art. And here are some of the calendar art pictures, but the artist here, you know, without understanding of really of the artistic form, and rather, you know, using the techniques in using the light and shade, and kind of that kind of realist type of approach in dealing with the imageries to sell the products, commercial products here, okay. And but soon, you know, China has that kind of very harmonious, peaceful, self-reliance, this kind of state changed. It changed because the Western European powers is start to, you know, through the trade, they start to come to, you know, establish in to the Oriental countries. And here is the first opium, this is the first opium war in 1840. That was considered as the modern China began in that way. The reason happened is that you know, the British you know, planned opium in India and sell it in China. And when the Chinese government stood up, tried to ban that, and then there's the British army followed. And China, you know, as a country, is totally it's not without this kind of a knowledge of the world, and defeated. And then there's the unequal treaty signed, like Hong Kong signed to British for 99 years. And then the British opium business went back, returned to China. And close to the late 19th century, Japan had a war with China, and the Chinese Navy was defeated totally. It has many reasons, but one of the reasons is the country has been, in such long years, relied on this self-reliance, and without a knowledge is about how the world is changing, especially when the in 19th century, when the European countries entered into the industrial stage. So what happened is that the defeat of Beiyang Fleet and the invasion of Manchuria and the invasion of Taiwan and the world repatriations, and the Chinese government also conceded to these failures. The picture here is really is the Japanese, from the Japanese propaganda picture, is how they celebrate the victory of the war and killing the Chinese soldiers. Okay, so China entered into a very, very dark stage. And the royal court started really to close the whole country and do not like the Chinese to have any contact with the outside of the world. And at the same time, they didn't take care of their own people well. And this is the Empress Dowager Cixi. And this is the Chinese people outside of this Forbidden Palace, living in a very poor condition. And when this, in late Qing Dynasty, when this minority, when the whole world, when the Western world changed into the industrial society, and China still embraced the to its own very old way, and especially ruled by this very minority group coming from Northeast. Now it's become part of the China, and China was twice invaded by the minority groups. But when they came to this land with sophisticated culture, and they have to give in to many ways as Chinese do, and they adopt the Chinese way of living, and they start to use the Chinese language, and gradually it became assimilated, become part of the Chinese. But this is the late 19th century when the emperor living in a very luxurious life while the people were suffering from daily life. And this is one of the picture of city of Beijing. And this is city of Beijing, is the city for the capital city for the Qing China. And you can see the fortress there. It's totally, it's not in good shape. It seems like the government was very corrupted, and the officials are very selfish. They were only thinking about their own personal gains rather than taking care of its own people. And when the Western culture came into China, and so it's brought up the it's very different. It's bring the conflict with the traditional value of the Chinese culture. Gradually it evolves to become the very hostile confrontation. And there's one of soldiers of Righteous Harmony Society, also called the Boxers. The Boxers start to have this kind of, they use a very, this kind of simple, it's not a rational way in dealing with the problem. And then they kill, they burn churches, and they kill the foreigners. They want to stop this kind of, the foreign influence. But at the same time, their own way of traditional way of living, of its own industry was really under the threat of the European, under the European influence. And when the Boxers started to rebel, Qing Dynasty at the very beginning, they didn't really see any value, but later they want to manipulate the situation. Even Cixi declared war to the Western powers, and they tried to use the Boxers, to stop the foreign influence. But the result is, as the eight nation alliance, invaded Beijing, and they took the Forbidden City, and this is the One of the earlier pictures is painted by an American painter. It's about the American troops here coming to the Beijing and burned the fortress and came into Beijing. And this is one of the Russian paintings. It's indicated how the Russian armies came into Beijing. This is one of the photos of during those years were taken. And Beijing was besieged, and also the royal family escaped. You know, they fled out of the city. And here is the army, you know, enter into the Forbidden City. And you can see, even though this is a relatively, you know, just a few days after the royal court, you know, fled from Beijing, but you can see the city, even the royal palace was not really in good shape. When I was reading that, I was even shocked, you know. And here is the in the Forbidden City inside, you know, the foreign soldiers, they're occupied the Forbidden City. And also the burning of the of Beijing, and this is Tiananmen, you know, at that time. And finally, China, you know, conceded to the failure, to the defeat. And here is one of the treaty signed. It's called the Boxer Indemnity. In this situation here, and also. The result is that, you know, the China has to pay eight nation alliance $335 million US dollars. And it's equal to 450 million taels. Taels is one measure of the, you know, of the silver. So it's really symbolic because at that time China has 450 million people. So everyone get that share. So they want to give Chinese a lesson is about, you know, what they did wrong, you know, to the foreign culture. At that time, China was really declined, and also that brought the Qing government down. And here is the eight nation alliance troops came in. They, you know, they beheaded the boxers, and here is some interesting pictures. It's of the some of the cartoon when the Chinese official at the left side, you see, was screaming, and also in front there is the Britain, the Germany and the Russian and France and Japan is looking at China, try to cut this pie and to split and to take their share. And during those years, and at this side you can see is a dragon, were slain by these the other animals. Symbolizes different countries. This is also at that time in the early 20th century is a poster indicated how China was divided by the foreign powers. But this change is was something interesting. And this is an old picture. It's about the Boxer Rebellions at indemnity. And it's about that treaty. It's the only the U.S. government spend that money to return that gave to the Chinese government to let them to send students coming to the United States to study. Okay, and also it's very interesting. In order to prepare these young people come to the United States to study, and they form the preparatory schools for these young students. And later, these preparatory schools become the Tsinghua University and the Peking University, which are the best schools in China. And the Chinese modern education start from this time. Okay, and also in 1911, this is 100 years ago, and there's the Republic, Republic Revolution. And China finally overthrew the Qing dynasty and established a republic. And this is the person, his name is Sun Yat-sen, and he is the leader of the revolution. And he himself went through tremendous struggle, and he had so many failures, but he never gave up. And finally, overthrew the Qing dynasty, established the republic. And also, it's very interesting, he was also educated in the West, in the United States. And he lived in Hawaii for a while and also traveled in the United States. And you know, his idea is about New China. It's very similar, very much influenced by the US Constitution. These pictures are the revolutionaries at that time, you know, participated in this revolution, overthrew the Qing Dynasty. This is Dr. Sun Yat-sen with the revolutionary troops. Then another thing happened. Okay, in 1919, it's the end of the World War I. China supposedly is the ally of the countries, won the war. And then there's a peace, Paris Peace Conference. This Paris Peace Conference is a bold result. Is even China is as a country, to win the war, but then the peace treaty and force the Chinese government to give to pass the Germany's privilege in China to Japanese, and this create outcry in China. This is 1919 May 4th movement. And the students went to Tiananmen and gave protest against this treaty. And also the consequence of the Paris Peace Conference is about the rise of Nazi Germany and World War II, and also the Japanese alliance to the fascism. Okay, and World War II started. And this is also, you can see, the First World War didn't really bring any justice, to the countries, who were exploited or invaded. And this is, and also May 4th movement. In May 4th movement, young students and Chinese scholars, they have a slogan, they advocate Mr. D and Mr. S. D stand for democracy, S stand for science. They think the way only to save China is to advocate democracy and science. And this triggered many things happening later on. Later, the rise of the there's the waves of Chinese students coming to the West to study. They want to learn the Western way to reform its own country. And also it's about the Communist Party, the founding of the Communist Party in 1921. This summer I went back to China. I was watching one of the programs of run in Hong Kong. It's talk about the founding of the Chinese Communist Party. And it talk about those people coming to Shanghai and when they meet. At that time they had no clue about what Marxism was really about. So what they had a copy of American Communist Party, the outlines of the party, and then they basically copied that, to create the Chinese Communist Party. And this is one of the paintings by a Chinese painter who was painting Chairman Mao and the other, historical figures in that meeting. It's quite interesting. And another person is very important. His name is Cai Yuanpei. Okay, he was a traditionally educated scholar, but also later on, he became a very important figure in Chinese modern education in founding the Tsinghua and the Beida University, and also he studied in Germany. And is really the first minister of education in Republic of China, and the president of Peking University. And later, he himself helped build develop the national national school of arts. And in his teaching, he really believed it's about the education ethics, intelligence, athletics. And also the aesthetics. And he think educated people to appreciate the beauty, to develop the sense of aesthetic, the appreciation is very important in modern, the modern education. And here is in 1872, the first group of teenager students going to study in the United States. They average 12 years old. And many of them came to this country and returned. And many of them played a very important role in the development of modern China. And actually, you know, maybe for our young students, when I talk to my students about them, they have no clue about what kind of influence, what kind of connection between China and the United States. And actually, this relationship is really developed early. This is 1926, 70 Tsinghua students is on the board of a boat coming to the United States to study. And also study board become a very trend. And here are two persons. One is Zhou Enlai, the other one is Deng Xiaoping. Later they became very important figure in China, in New China. And especially Deng Xiaoping, you know, under his leadership and the China experienced a very historical and precedent development of this economic development, okay. But in art school, this is one of the art school, it's the first national art school established in 1918. And here is the first president of that school, and he has also studied overseas in Japan, and this is the very, very the first beginning. And this school is really, you know, existed till today, okay. We're going to see the history of the school, and here is another very important figure. His name is Lin Fengmian, and he became the president, and he studied in France, and here is the dean of that school. It's Wen Yiduo. He is one of the revolutionaries, and a very famous poet, you know, in China. And he studied in the United States, actually at the Chicago Art Institute of Chicago. And here are, I just looked through the, you know, the book of our of the Central Academy. They record its history, and I look at them. Many of them, all of them there, most of their faculties studied overseas. So they brought these influences about this modern student teaching back to China. And here is a picture of student of the National Art School in the middle. And his name is Yang Xianrang. He's later, you know, the teacher of Xu Bing, you know, in our academy. Three figures, you know, in modern Chinese art teaching plays a very important role. One is Lin Fengmian, okay, and you know, he was born in 1900, died in 1991, and Liu Haisu in the middle, and also Xu Weihong at the right. Okay, three of them are individuals, very unique, with unique personalities, and they do not agree with each other. And they went to the West and with different way of looking at the world, but they all want to bring the things back to China to revolutionize the you know, the Chinese art. Let's look at the first one, Lin Fengmian. Lin Fengmian, from 1925, studied in Europe and in Paris. First in Dijon of the National Fine Art Schools, and later in Paris. And his ideas is about art is also quite interesting. In 1925, he returned to Beijing to become the president of the National Art School. But in Paris, there, you know, at the very beginning, he was very academically trained painters, you know, following this Western type of approach. But one day he met a person, you know, a famous artist also in French artist, and talked to him. And it's really talking about, because Western art in late 19th century and early 20th century went through you know, tremendous development. And someone persuaded him, he said, look, your Chinese culture has this tremendous heritage. You need to draw like that, not this in the Western way. So I'm going to go very fast. And you know, this is the painting. He was influenced by the Fauvism, and you can see his later paintings is by the Matisse, the influence, and also he was really talking about you know, expressing personal experience. And this is one of the pictures in his later years. but he has a very difficult time in China. China went through this tremendous, you know, period of a struggle. And also himself is at the beginning, you know, he was the, you know, gave some influence to students, but his ideas, it seems like it's not really chosen by, you know, by the, you know, China's fate in establishing his school. And in his later years, he was imprisoned by the Communist Party, and later released, but, you know, moved to Hong Kong. But even now, today, you know, his art appreciated, but he went to, you know, his influence to the Chinese art, you know, it's nowadays people really talking about, you know, how important. But it seems like history didn't choose him. And Liu Haisu is another person. He's very interesting. He's the first one to open an art school in China. And also, he was very famous, for the first person in using the nude figures in China. And they create the criticism from society. Even, you know, became a government wanted person. And but he traveled extensively. He didn't study in Europe, but he traveled extensively there, and, you know, even met Picasso and Matisse, and also brought some influence back to China. In 1959, you know, because he didn't agree with certain government policies, and he was charged as right wing and put aside, and not giving any influence to later development of Chinese art. And this is the first time when he, you know, used the nude figures, and he was condemned as a traitor of art. This is the, you know, his school, later the artist with nude models. You can see the nude models there in the center. This is his painting he painted in his early years. And we can see there are strong influence of Gauguin, Cezanne. But later, you know, he returned to China, and he also try to combine this kind of Western influence with the in using the Chinese media. And this is the painting, you know, he created, you know, incorporated with the ink and you know, very straight, direct color painting techniques. Another person is Xu Beihong. In 1919, you know, he went to France to study, and later he returned to China, and in 1949 became the president of Central Academy of Fine Arts, which is the continuation of the National School of Art. It's very interesting, in 1912, he met another person, he's Kang Youwei. Kang Youwei is a very important person in Chinese modern history, you know, want to reform the country, give the influence, but his work, his ideas really didn't, you know, didn't succeed in China. But he met Xu Beihong and convinced, you know, he told Xu Beihong, Chinese art would perish unless it learned from Western art. And that became one of the, you know, the motivations of the, when Xu Beihong went to China. This is, Xu Beihong went to China, and this is the studies that he had. What we see here is a very academic drawing, but the drawing given to the, you know, very scientific way of observational approach to the paint, to the human form, and the understanding of the anatomy, and also artistic treatment of the forms. Here, you know, he gave an intense study, you know, focus onto the onto this kind of study. And this is you know, some of the drawings he did, and his this is one of the portrait of his his teacher, and he studied with this very classical training academic painter. And here we see some of his works and his self-portrait, and also his study of portrait in while he was studying in France. And he was his own personal work, and so influenced by the Delacroix in looking at this the massacre of Xi'an. Later on, he went back to China, and he tried to bring the, you know, this entire this body of Western knowledge in dealing with the oil painting. And this is some of the painting he did then, the landscape painting. And also, more important is he started to paint, you know, this kind of grand narrative. And he thought about a country, you know, and, you know, went through this tremendous difficulties. and the miserable life, and he wanted to use the painted form, you know, to echo this, you know, the China state, you know, in finding its own in its own way. And this is some of the very large dimension oil paintings that he did. Even today, when we look at that, it's still it's very powerful. He used this, you know, borrowed from the classical Chinese literature, with the, you know, as the theme. Some of the landscape paintings, and also this is he was very, you know, he combined it with the Western way of dealing with chiaroscuro, with the, you know, the Chinese way in using the ink, brush ink. And he's well known for these kind of, you know, for the paintings of horses. In his horses, it's no longer just the, you know, application of the ink. It's he brought ink with this dimensions, the depiction of dimensions, and based on the anatomy with the horses, you know, with the images here. And we can see this one here, and he used the, you know, the chiaroscuro in, the, you know, and also combined with the anatomy. This never happened in Chinese painting before him. And in 1937, Japan invaded China. That also created influence. And this is the Chinese army tried to defend the country. That is how China was taken by the Japanese in the World War II. This is, you know, it, you know, the Japanese came, invaded China, and really committed this war crime. And nowadays, when we look at that, it's still, this is the Chinese army, you know, captured the Japanese soldier. And at the same time, there was another person, his name is Lu Xun, and he gave very profound influence to the Chinese art. And he is a young, as a young student, he studied in Japan. And at the beginning time, he studied medicine. But later, you know, when he looked at that, one day he was in the movie theater and see how those audience was laughing, was have this kind of joyful, you know, claiming, you know, in the theater, when the Chinese civilians were killed by the Japanese troops, and then he decided, you know, to devote himself to the Chinese revolutionary literatures, and he introduced one of the artists to the Chinese art. This is Ko Huiz, and Ko Huiz at that time came to China. You know, his you know her work. You know, with this powerful treatment of the, you know, human figures and imagery of, you know, symbolically indicating the social change, and they gave a strong influence, okay, here. And also another group of figure is living in the very remote areas because they are communists, and the nationalists was trying very hard to get rid of them, so they went to a very remote area, survived there. And here's Chairman Mao and you know, Zhou Enlai, who also studied in France. They were living in these caves. At that time, they developed their own ideas is about revolutionary art. Here is Chairman Mao, is they talk about proletarian art, and art for the masses, art for the proletarian politics. You know, they talk about revolutionary romanticism and realism. This is one of the, you know, the first in the communist base, and you see the first art school in Yan'an. This is the students, you know, in the school doing the artwork. And then you see the Chinese artists, and you can see their work strongly influenced by the, you know, Ko Huiz artwork. And this is a person, many of these persons, these are many of these people later become very influential figures in China's modern art education, like the artist of this one is Hu Yichuan, and later he is the president of Guangzhou Academy of Fine Arts. And this is also another artist, he's later became the president of the Lu Xun Academy in the northeast part of China. And here we can see the artist there using woodcut. And this is one of the professors of our academy, at the Central Academy, and his name is Li Hua. He's talking, used a figure tying together is screaming and to symbolize China in a struggle. And we can see during that time, even some of the techniques is very cruel, but the artists is really devote themselves into looking at the life and using the art to reflect their direct experience, you know, influenced by the historical incidents that we see that come, you know, following that time. This is one of the lihuas of the woodcut, okay. And also the class struggle become very important theme in the communist art. And it's about how to let people, you know, have this equal rights in land, try to rid of the exploitation. And also this is about the Revolutionary War. It's by later the president of Central Academy. This is one of the paintings by a later painter. And he painted about the end of the nationalist rule in China. And after that, this is, you can see at this time, you know, the artist was using this very very Western technique in dealing with the Chinese experience. It's about the communist troops enter into the president office, you know, the compound, and how to end the nationalist rule in China. And then China went to another period in 1950, and the Central Academy of Fine Arts established. And this is the very first group of students. And also Xu Beihong became the president. And he is, while is really sharing his experience of what he learned from France, especially through this very academic training, and also he gave very strong emphasis to the traditional Chinese painting. And in the center here is also is one of the famous Chinese painters. And Xu Beihong invited him to the Central Academy. And also at the same time, there is another group of figure brought different ideas to the Central Academy. They come from the communist space, Yan An, okay. When we look at that, you know, at the very top very top right corner was the later president of Central Academy of Fine Arts. His name is Jiang Feng. And at this side is China's Artists Association, the president of Artists Association. His name is Cai Ruohong. And these two group of people coming to the Central Academy, but they give very different ideas about how to, you know, to teach art. But in Xu Beihong, and he was, has very particular, you know, about this kind of aesthetic quality. In his, he emphasized drawing as the foundation. When drawing a stylistic preference, you know, he emphasizes making image more square-like, less being round, giving into even a dirtier surface rather than keep it clean, or even light painting or image being awkward rather than sleek, okay. His ideas is still today influenced by the young Chinese artists. This is Xu Beihong during those years. And also China quickly went into this Cold War period, and all the foreign influences cut off due to the Cold War. At that time, it's the only way that Chinese artists to learn from the West is through Soviet Union. So at that time, there was one person, he came to China, a painter came to China, and he started to, you know, to do the workshop, and his name is Mark Simov. He brought different ideas. It's also further, you know, enhanced Xu Beihong's way of teaching, of painting and drawing. We can see, you know, this is some of his paintings. But during those years, you know, Central Academy went to this kind of conflict. And the conflict is about the art serving for the large masses, or art really, you know, it should be taught as this very high culture. But always is the other side, art, served for the masses, has become dominant. So the Central Academy, professors and the students, they went to the the countryside and participate in the life of working people, and start to. This is some of the images there, and also in their artwork, and they were trying to use this kind of grand narrative, format of grand narrative to talk about the revolutionary experience under the leadership of the Communist Party. And here is about a woman expressing her own miserable experience with the person with the landlord who control the production materials, and while the poor people were suffering during that time. This is very typical of the Chinese communist artwork. And also they were using this kind of Western type of drawing as support of the art. And this is this is some of the art professors in 1962. In 1960, it became a very important period because finally at that time, the argument stopped and they think the art school should be a school, should be an educational institute. So in 1960 to 1964, students back to the studio, they really concentrate, and also there's the exchange with the Russian artists too. But soon, 4 years later, in 1964, the Communist Party has this kind of a political agenda, brought up to the whole country, and then the education stopped. This is the young students, they went outside, they doing the posters as their study. And soon in 1966, and the darkest age in China's modern history began, is the Mao's Cultural Revolution. During this Cultural Revolution, all art schools closed, and art really become the tool serving for the communist propaganda. And even Mao's wife and had personally gave influence to these art education. And by that time, they have this kind of very avant-garde type of thinking. They just sent artists to the countryside, living with it's called eat, live, and work with the masses. And it become a very dominant type of education. So there was no on-campus studio work. And here is one of our professors working with the students. And the students were chosen based on what kind of red family they come from, rather based on their art skills. So the China went through that period. Finally, the Cultural Revolution ended. And again, the argument about whether we use new model or we shouldn't use new model become an issue. And luckily, Chairman Mao, this is one of the Mao's note to the to some of the officials in the Culture Administration, and really talking about the study of new form is a scientific research. It should be allowed. And then after that, the Central Academy, start to have this, went to its own way in building up the, as a higher institute of education institute of the art, and this is one of our artists met in of this exhibition met in this at the gate of Central Academy. This is Central Academy today, and newly built. Administration building, and this is Central Academy has a very good, very modern art museum. Students practicing traditional painting, and oil painting, woodcut, and sculpture, and their sculpture studio is also we see very different forms, different ideas about artistic forms being practiced in the school today. This is a Central Academy's library. In front of that, we see Rodin's, sculpture, and even they built this hall here, and to have this very Western standard of sculptures as the type of the drawing to set up for the drawing training. This is inside of Central Academy. This is two drawings done by an artist who is in this exhibition. His name is Liu Junchen. This is the study that he had while he was in the academy. And now in academy, students are doing many different things. And also there is, the artists encounter new problems. The traditional ideas, values is challenged, and also our market becomes strong influence. And this is the students, one of the student work trying to respond to the, this very odd development, happened in China, accompanying this economic development. And also here's another school in the south. It's called the Guangzhou Academy of Fine Arts. This is the old campus. The old campus, there used to be the entire academy, now served as graduate school. And here are some student work. And you can see the student work is also experimental. And this is a very, the sculpture form. And also one of the students, this is the work. It's a very large dimension, you can see in that picture there. And with this, demonstrate the capability of the students in dealing with the form. And also communist icons being used as one of the source of information. They were start to express different ways of in looking at the tradition. This is their new campus. And I just went through here. It's probably the largest art school in Asia. And this is the whole school. And it's serving for only 5,000 students. And it's half the entire size of the campus of Cal State Long Beach. At Cal State Long Beach, we have similar size of the campus, but we have 35,000 students, while they have 5,000 students on campus there. And this is the new art building and the library and the student hall for the lecture and the students doing their painting in the studio. And this is the student dorm and also the student recreation center. They have their own, students have their own exhibition space. And this is the sculpture studio of the Guangzhou Academy. This is inside sculpture studio. You can see, the Chinese people. I say that, yes, Chinese government, gave the budget, but the Chinese people really spend so much their own energy in developing their art institute. This is inside of the sculpture studio. And in the first row, the second is our exchange students and the professor and the chair of the department, Chris Miles, who is also the curator of this exhibition. And we visited school, and now between Guangzhou Academy and our school, we have the exchange relationship. And there in the distance is their new art museum. This is inside art museum. And the Guangzhou Academy went pretty much followed the Central Academy format, went through, but this is their most recent artworks. But when look through that, and you can see, the students is also trying to, have this very bold artistic experiment, and this is the student work. Inside the museum, and this is some of the older paintings, and it's very much under the strong ideological control of the communist ideas. And the better school went through from the very observational drawing, and which gave the foundation of the artistic experience of the Chinese art students. All artists from this exhibition attended the school in these schools or similar like this. So many of all of them had a very profound training in very solid training in the this kind of very scientific, very observational based drawings. And this is the students went through there. And but China is also now experiencing new problems. It's like this education is really very much about this very grand narrative type of approach. And but at the same time, it's dealing with this very popular culture and our market. This is some of the older forms. This one is missing. And Lin Fengmian, the president of National School of Art. Finally, his artwork was recognized, by the government. and many of his work. This is his early work. I have some image missing there. And this is Huang Yongyu. But this is a modern Chinese artwork, and there's a kind of a different attitude and also the cynicism in looking at art today. This is one of, I taught, after I finished the Central Academy, I taught in the senior high school. This is one of my students. Her name is Xiao Lu. And she also brought some new ideas into the exhibition with a gun shooting the her artwork. This is new ideas. Even some of use the Madame Mao's portrait there is trying to have different ways in looking at the history. This is using the digital medias, and China is experiencing a new rise of this with this resources. It's a very bountiful resources of information and the new tools of in expressing them, themselves. This is one of the images, with three-dimensional objects by Lin Tianmiao. This is also Gu Wenda, one of the well-known artists in using the traditional medium, but combined with different, this new conceptual way of dealing with painted form. And here again, it's one of the artists, his name is Shuping. Actually, he is the first, he's the person who originate, this, the exhibition of this. In 1996, we met, we were classmates. So, and then we talked about it. And at that time, I only met another two artists. Today, when we have this show, we have 40 artists are teaching in the United States. And this is the art schools located in China. There are 8 major art academies from Luxun Academy, Central Academy, Tianjin, Xi'an, Sichuan, and Hubei, and China, and to Guangzhou Academy. And today, they continue this. And at the very end, here is a quotation. It's by American Spaniard, George Santayana, the American writer, and he said, "Those who cannot remember the past are condemned to fulfill it." There's misquoted, there, because of what we most know is that for those who do not remember the past are condemned to repeat. But I looked through, there's different versions. I like this version better. And, now the burden is on our shoulder. We are obligated to fulfill it. Thanks.
Thank you everyone for being here. First of all, I want to thank Professor Yu Ji. The lecture was very informative and I learned a lot myself, even though I grew up in China. There's so much I didn't know. It is so interesting to see the evolution and progression of Chinese art in this historical background. And perhaps my lecture could be a small extension to talk about artists who travel from China, who come to the US, now that our practice is drawn from our cross-cultural experience. And I think that's the similarity we share, and that's what brought us together to put together this exhibit. And thank you also for the vision to start the association. And this is our 4th exhibition. We're really proud to be here. And thank you for the department and the gallery, Xiao Hong, for your very hard work. Thank you. So I will be talking about my work. Please see this as a humble example of my colleague's work. There are many exceptional pieces in the show. So just a little flavor of what we do. So I selected a number of projects that draw upon Chinese cultural content. And this piece is called Dida. It's an installation piece. It's made using salt and water. I worked with this simple material for a number of years, because I'm interested in the interaction between the two materials and how they transform. Salt can be as solid as rock and as free as water. And this piece, I put saturated salt water at the very top, and the burette allows the control of the dripping speed. It travels downwards, down onto these vinyl steps. As you can imagine, the movement is very quiet and meditative. They leave behind the residue and the history, which is the crystal. And Dida in Chinese means the sound of water dripping. It also means the sound of clock ticking. To me, that is very interesting. And traditionally, the very first Chinese clock is also made using the water dripping mechanism. So that was the whole process of thinking about time and change and how things could transform. When the water travels down to the very bottom, it gets collected in the third burette. So there are two on top, and the idea is in the end, it gets recycled back to the top. This is the earlier stage of my work, and it's a very labor-intensive piece because I had to go back to the gallery every night to cycle the worker back, the water back up. One of the viewers came to the exhibit and she made a comment that I really appreciated. She said that the piece made the room breathe. It is very quiet, but you can also hear a little bit of the sound of dripping. The next salt and water piece is called Goal Number One. I have a series of these salt work. I chose two of them. Goal is a Chinese game of territory control. It's played with black and white stone. You might have seen it maybe in Kung Fu movies. The idea is to occupy land. And I thought in this time, our current time, it seems to be quite interesting. The land and the occupation is something we're so interested in. So the orientation is 19 by 19 grid. The objects you see, they're shotgun shells. They're used shotgun shells. And I also filled it with saturated salt water. As the crystal grows, it oozes out of the space of this space that actually held gunpowder originally. And as it grows out, the metal starts to be corroded. So there's this really silent drama that took place within each shotgun shell. And over time, this overall black formation slowly turned into white. It looks like a tiny explosion when you look at it. So that's a detailed view from the top. You see the variation of the crystal formation. In 2004, I went to Nebraska for artist residency, and before I went, I saw this image in the brochure. There were 350 tons of free clay for artists to use, and I thought, what could I do with this free material at such huge amount? And I created a little house that is a replica of my parents' home. It's great to hear Professor Yuji's lecture, so you know a little bit about Chinese Cultural Revolution if you didn't know about it before. So my parents were among those young people who were sent down to the village. They stayed there for 10 years, and in the village, the tradition is that the sons are given the resource and the men in the village come and help him to make a new house right before he gets married. And so my father built his own house with the help of the villagers, and he made many houses helping other men in the village. Somehow it seemed quite important to me that as a Chinese woman, I came to America and I decided to make a house of my own. It's a very empowering experience. It's not the life size, it's about, I'd say, about two-thirds of the size. This type of one-room house is very common in northeast China, where my family's from. And of course, I didn't know anything about how to build a house. It seemed such a daunting project. So I started communicating with my dad, and he would send me sketches. This is one of his sketches. He would talk to me about, you know, how all the parts are built, put together, what they're called, and he drew me a really simple sketch of how the inside structure looks like. So during the 2 months time at our farm, I spent the first 6 weeks making bricks. I had a lot of great help from the local school, the students, the architecture school from University of Nebraska, Lincoln also came to help. So that's the director of Art Farm. And then there were times I spent the whole day turning the adobe bricks. It's a mixture of sand and straw and clay. They're very touchy. So they're moist once you finish making the mold. and they need to be turned, because if it dries too fast, it cracks. If it dries, if it's too moist, they crack. If it's too windy, they crack. So you have to turn them. I'm like, I'm turning my eggs. And it was very labor intensive, and I got very fit that summer. So when the little house is finished, it's standing on the sculpture prairie facing south, as traditionally how the house is positioned. Inside of the little house, I pasted American newspaper article about China in 2004. So in a sense, what happened at that time, how China is viewed in America, is recorded in this small collection in the little house. To me, it's a very autobiographical piece, because I'm a Chinese woman. I came to America to really try to find a way of continuing my career and life. And the little house is also standing on foreign land. And I see the parallel between the two. So here are some images of the work in progress. I learned very rough carpentry. And that's a volunteer came to help with the thatching of the roof. We use mostly local material and recycled material from the farm. And this is called the mountain wall on the side. I think a lot of our Chinese friends would know. It is the hardest wall to lay, because every brick needs to be cut as you go to the peak. This is the morning the little house was done. I had hoped that I could stay in it for a while, but I had to come back to teach, so I spent one night. And originally I thought it must be pretty scary. I'm in the middle of nowhere, there's no electricity, no one can hear me, but the little house, the moon came in the night I stayed in, and I felt so much just like being home. So this type of house has a long tradition in China. From 6000 BC, from the Neolithic period of Banpo, again, our Chinese friends might know, it's also a really archetypal type of dwelling that can be found all over the world. And while I was in Nebraska, the visitors came and actually asked me, have you heard about our sod house? It's also made using basically straw and clay, it's held together by the roots of the grass. And I thought, how interesting, even though we're on the opposite side of the world, we share the same usage, the same reason for using these humble materials, because there's no wood, there's no money, to make our first homes. So that's an image of the sod house, and I thought maybe we're not that different. And also, from that time on, I realized in my work, I'm trying to look at what we share as human beings, and not necessarily how different we are. Of course, we have different culture, but something fundamentally we really understand and relate to one another. That's the moonlight. So the little house is still there. It's aging quite a bit. Typically, they can last for 30 years or 40, but it needs maintenance every year. So I haven't really had a chance to do that. In 2006, I went to California for a different residency, and here's the second project of the house face installation series. I call it house face because I think every artist goes through a house face, and it seems to be more true than not. So the second project, it's called Recall. The structure, the orientation, and scale is exactly the same. The material is different. It's made of 100% paraffin wax. I developed this technique. A lot of my work comes from playing, experimenting with material. So I developed this technique of pouring liquid wax in water. Then I put my hand under this liquid wax. It solidifies once it touches the water. As I pull it up slowly, the liquid keeps rolling forward, so I can stretch it quite long. So the longest is about 9 feet, and I think I could go even longer. So within seconds, it solidifies. As you can imagine, if you touch it, it breaks. So even though I know the material very well, when I was suspending it, I was breaking about 5 to 10% myself. So Recall is really speaking of the fragility of the idea of shelter and home. It is the image and it is the space that make you feel like it referred to protection, but it cannot even withhold a single light touch. So that's a detail. When the drip lifts away from the water, you can actually see the one drop that's the very end of the drip. That's how it looks when it was made. So material and process is as important to me as my interest in investigating cultural subjects. Sometimes when they combine, I think that's the exciting time where a project is working for me. One thing I do want to mention is that the roof of this old barn is actually quite aged, and the sunlight will project these light rings down to the ground. So over the throughout the day, the light will glide through the whole space, and the house is like glowing and floating in the center. So this is the deinstall of the piece. As you can see, when it drops from the line, it just shatters into 1,000 pieces. I started working with red thread about 3 years ago, and all the Chinese people know about this legend, the legend of the red thread. It is told that when children are born, we're connected with our soulmate by an invisible piece of red thread. I like the idea of that it's invisible, but it is red. So I played with the thread and I developed this first piece called Lore. I made a number of different compositions. So this is Lore Rise at Chinese Culture Center. I hand spiral these discs, so there are singles, and the doubles are actually made from one thread. And in the very center, I pierce the disc with a needle. The needle then is tied to the ceiling. So they're all kind of hovering and floating. The movement is, there's the needle you can see, the movement is quite different. In the Chinese Culture Center, it rises, a very smooth but large movement. And here you can see the lower part, and then it goes to the higher one. Detail. And this is in Los Angeles, where I composed the whole piece to be more level. It's like looking at a lake. And when viewers walk by, all the discs start to sway. There's kind of a nice interaction between the two. And to me, I feel like it's really talking about connections and that confusion that even though you have this faded potential, but there's always entanglements and you may or may not find the other one. It's a story that's shared and understood by people from many different places. So I took this project to many places. Actually, the project took me to many places. This is in Finland. I also took it to China. Actually, I don't have an image here. This was last year in Grand Rapids during the Art Prize competition. And this is one of my favorite images of that particular exhibit. When I brought it back to China, it was wonderful to see the viewer response. There's a sense of warmth. People understand the story. And there's a sense of pride to see the legend illustrated in such a way. And when I take it to different countries, I feel like I'm just sharing that little bit of Chinese culture that everyone can relate to and understand. They tell me, we have something similar too. This is how we refer to that connection. Within the same series, I have about 4 installations. This is called Tie and Tie. It's a video projection piece. So it's an image of my hands underwater with a pool of red thread. I'm untangling, just simply opening the thread. I thought that, you know, the thread should tangle very easily. However, because of the water presence, I can keep pulling it apart. In the end, when I find the ends, I tie it together into a knot. So a few images here. Oh, I do want to say it's projected on a pool of white string. So it's the lines projected on lines. That's the installation view. This is the last project I'd like to show you. It's called the Mending Projects from earlier this year. And because it's so new, I'm going to read about it, which I don't usually do, but I think this is much more clear. The installation consists of thousands of forged Chinese scissors suspended from the ceiling, pointing downwards. The hovering, massive cloud of scissors alludes to distant fear, looming violence, and worrisome uncertainty. The performer sits beneath the countless sharp blades of scissors and perform an ongoing simple task of mending. As each visitor enters the space, one is asked to cut off a piece of the white cloth hung near the entrance and offer the cut section to the performer. The mended section grows in size throughout the duration of the performance and takes over the vast area of the floor beneath the scissors. Simple and minute actions, if persistent, may initiate the hope and trust and healing in the most troubled times. Each visitor's thoughts and touch are embedded and transferred through the handling and passing of the cut fabric pieces. The installation performance evokes urgency, concern, or even fear. Their overwhelming situation, however, is softened and eventually balanced by the silent persistence of a simple action of mending. So I think this is the last image. And I'll do something with scissors in our show too, but it'll be much, much smaller. And I'm very much looking forward to seeing the exhibition. Thank you very much.
Maybe you could describe for us what you're going to do in the gallery with your installation here. And give us a little story, because maybe people won't get a chance to hear directly from you what your project is.
I wanted to continue to work with scissors because I think it's such a powerful object. I forgot to mention that in Chinese tradition, you should never point scissors at someone. It's just not polite. It brings bad luck. So the piece I'll be making here, it's wrapped with thread. So the scissors completely wrapped where it could not function to cut anymore. And then there will be many lines, I don't know, 100, 200 radiating out from the scissors, which is holding it in space too. So it's kind of frozen in space. The piece is called Strain. It's after this piece, and it sits in a corner, so it's held there. I hope you come to see it.
And maybe one of the art historians in the house can help me out about the Sword of Damocles, because that's what I kind of thought about with the scissors suspended down. There is a Western. Yeah, no, I was thinking of the suspended scissors, and she was sitting underneath of them. There was a king who, when he had to make an important decision, would sit underneath a sword that was suspended by a thread. And he would want to make his decision quickly and get it done right, and he would move out of the way. So it was a way of putting pressure on, but when I saw you sitting with the scissors, I kind of thought of that.
That's
being both nervous and
it was actually,
focused at the same time.
It's a very calming experience. Somehow you overcome fear. When we were working in the gallery, everyone was scared at the beginning, but at the end, everyone was standing underneath and chatting away. And I said, you know, you're under the scissors, you're like, it's okay. Somehow that hovering mass creates a very different space. And I do want to see it as an empowering piece. You know, I talk about being empowered by the house. It's about the power of healing, the simple action of a woman. It doesn't have to be me. I do think someone else could sit there and sew. It's just, there's no fear. And because of that, that harsh, threatening energy is then balanced and diluted. So.